Now, Japan declares COVID emergency in Tokyo just 2 weeks before the start of the Olympic Games. US yields dive and stocks retreat, and Bitcoin remains stable, hinting that a dive below the $30,000 mark will likely be less violent than we first thought. Welcome to Swissquote's Daily Market Talk. So the three major US indices closed Thursday session in the red, and most Asian indices traded south on Friday on rising COVID concerns after Japan released a state of emergency just 2 weeks before the start of the Olympic Games. Now, there will be no spectator apparently, but the games will happen still according to the latest news here in Europe. It's quite hard to believe that the cases are rising again, as the Euro 2020 spectators are by thousands in the stadiums with no masks or visible distancing measures whatsoever, screaming, partying, and hugging each other as if a global pandemic has never happened. So it naturally raises some questions about the possibility of a Delta variant crisis hereabouts as well. And we could see it in the investor sentiment, in the investor mood yesterday, when the Euro stocks slid more than 2%, closing the session below the 4,000 mark for the first time in 3 weeks, as the German industrial orders also showed an unexpected slump in May earlier this week. So that was the worst number recorded since the beginning of the pandemic due to weaker demand outside the Eurozone, hinting that the vaccine rollout could only help this much the European economies keeping their head above water if actually we see another global wave of contagion. Now, the rising COVID concerns hit all three major US indices, as I said, but reflation stocks were hit more than the tech names yesterday. Nasdaq came off from its all-time highs but remains comfortably upbeat. Still, we've seen a diverging picture among the FANG stocks as well. Apple, for example, eased some 0.9% from an all-time high, but Amazon renewed record on rising COVID concerns, which continue boosting the demand in e-commerce, obviously. Now, Chinese technology stocks continued feeling the pinch of the Chinese government crackdown. Alibaba literally dived below the $200 mark for the first time in more than a year and closed Thursday session with close to 4% loss. Didi lost another 5%. And I came across the UBS note posted yesterday telling clients that Chinese equities have potential to catch up and reverse the recent underperformance. They see a good potential in all Chinese stocks, but they prefer value names for now. They are cautious on Chinese technology names in the near future, but they also think that there is a great potential in these Chinese tech stocks once the dust settles. And I like the way they put it, because they say the tech regulatory actions represent short-term pain for long-term gain, they say. So that's exactly it. At some point, investors will come rushing to Chinese stocks, especially given how cheap they've become with the price-to-earnings ratio now below the historical averages, versus how expensive the US stocks are, especially the tech stocks, due to the unprecedented rise in their prices since the beginning of the pandemic. But again, looking at the market as a whole, there is no apparent reason whatsoever for the equity prices, at least in the US, to come down significantly, or the bubble to burst, as the US yields remain on a fading path. The US 10-year yield slumped below the 130% mark yesterday, so the Fed's dot plot showing a steeper rate hike path moving forward, or the warnings of higher and longer inflation, are no cause for concerns with regards to the Fed policy for now. And funny enough, inflation in China eased in June, while producer prices remained steady, a touch below the 9% mark. Anyway, the US yields continue diving. That's what matters, and the market rhetoric is clearly shifting from a transitory inflation to a transitory recovery right now, and that's probably what keeps these inflows into the US Treasuries high, combined with obviously the fact that we have a seasonally low issuance of Treasuries in July, and Fed coming back to the market after the July 4 break also gives a boost to these US Treasury holdings. So with all this, yields going lower and equities pushing higher is obviously the most reasonable market response response that we can have. But this time, we should keep in mind that rising COVID concerns are also accompanied by rising COVID cases, and how the Fed could react to that is yet to be seen. For now, investors don't seem concerned though, but there is still a risk for the equity rally to the downside. Though you would agree that no analyst would dare giving a bearish call on the market right now, as the excess liquidity that we see is what runs the show. And I came across a nice comment from an investor yesterday saying that for macro-based trades to work, so if you expect the rising inflation causing rising yields and lower equity as well, you need a certain critical mass of market liquidity. And by market liquidity, he actually means not Fed liquidity. And I agree with that. With the Fed liquidity, the only direction in equities is obviously north, and the only direction in the US yields is south, regardless of what happens elsewhere. Okay, with all this in hand, let's see where we are in terms of gold pricing this week. Now, gold had a good rebound since the price dip at $1,750 per ounce end of June, and the price of an ounce tested the $1,820 mark yesterday. Now, the plunging US yields explain a major part of the latest return to gold from investors, as lower yields decrease the opportunity cost of holding the non-interest bearing gold, obviously. Now, technical indicators hint that there is potential for a further positive push in these gold prices at the current levels. Now, the trend and momentum indicators turned positive at the beginning of this week, and the relative strength index is still below the 50% mark, pointing that we are nowhere close to a saturation on the buy side right now. Yet, knowing how profitable the risky trades are, how long would investors accept to remain seated on not so exciting gold is yet to be seen. I don't see potential for a rise in gold above the 200-day moving average that's near $1,830 mark if there isn't a significant bearish reversal in the US equity markets. Now, speaking of commodities, let's have a quick update on oil prices, as well as people now asking me my expectations on oil. Well, the price of US crude dipped below the $71 mark this week, yet rebounded past $73 after the EIA data showed a further and a more severe than expected decline in the US inventories last week, which actually withdrew by nearly 7 million barrels last week versus a 4 million barrel decline expected by analysts. So when you compare these numbers with the amount that the OPEC Plus is willing to unwind their production cuts by, meaning by less than 500,000 barrels per day, well, you pretty much have the answer on what direction the game is headed from a supply-demand perspective. However, the chaotic situation at the heart of the OPEC, the rising tensions between Saudi and the United Arab Emirates, the possibility of a nuclear deal between the US and Iran, which would throw an extra 4 to 6 million barrels supply per day to the global mix, and the rising COVID cases nowadays will likely limit the upside potential in oil near the $75-$78 per barrel area. The downside potential depends really on what happens on the OPEC front. Now, my base case scenario is that OPEC countries, Saudi Arabia and the United Arab Emirates, will work out a solution, and that should cap the potential of sizable downside correction in oil prices. So buyers will likely remain in charge of the market in case of a slide below the $70 mark, yet we will hardly see the barrel of US crude surpassing the $80 mark until there is more certainty on the COVID news front. Now, a quick word on Tesla. We have a nice symmetrical triangle forming on the daily chart, which will force investors to decide very soon what to do next with their Tesla holdings. Is Tesla a buy, or should the share price continue giving back some more of these past year's gains? Well, technically speaking, the oscillators give out a neutral signal for Tesla. The moving averages remain favorable for an additional positive push in the stock price, and overall technical deck says that Tesla is still a buy, but not a strong one right now. Now, last week, I was giving a fall for the price easing to $640-$620 area. We hit that spot. Now, I'm sideways. The short-term direction will likely depend on a positive or a negative breakout of the actual triangle. Also, Tesla's second quarter sales topped 200,000, which was good news as the chip shortage didn't hurt deliveries apparently in the first two quarters of this year. But Tesla sold slightly less cars in China in June, and rising competition in the EV sector is a real thing. Look at Volkswagen, as you would think that they're turning into an all-electric car maker. Now back to Tesla, we will have the answer on the next direction in the next couple of sessions, as I said. Finally, I will talk about Bitcoin a little bit. Bitcoin remains stuck within the $30,000-$35,000 range. Traders will continue watching out for a sustainable move below or above this range, but given the stabilization in prices that we see, a dive below the $30,000 mark will likely be less dramatic than it would have been a couple of weeks earlier, actually. Although, and given the rapid rise in prices, we don't have much evidence of an eventual support below the $30,000 mark. We shall actually see one forming between the $26,000-$28,000 region and approaching the $25,000 mark. This is all for this week. I'm Ipekas Kardeşkaya, and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and insightful to you. Please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions, and your questions below, and follow us on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again next week, and until then, good day trading and have a lovely weekend.